tree which we see before us today were laid in the year 1936 in Hyderabad, which was a part of undivided India. It was through some divine revelations the organization began, and brothers and sisters. And I'm very proud to say it was more the power of women in spirituality which was used, and the core group of 400 people stayed together, did everything as a unit and practiced spirituality in every action. After the partition, we shifted in India, in Rajasthan, to Mount Abu. Since that time, Mount Abu is our global headquarters. We started branching out in different parts of India. In Tamil Nadu, we started in the year 1970. And in the year 1970s, we also branched out overseas in London, America, Hong Kong, etc. Since the year 1981, we are affiliated to the United Nations as a non-governmental organization, and also with the UNICEF and many other related organizations. Today, we stand before you with nearly 10,000 branches in 148 countries of the world. And within the state of Tamil Nadu, we have nearly 300 branches in all districts and talukas. And we have, I should say, family members like you. Yes, I will repeat again, family members like all of you here. Nearly 10 lakh families all over the world taking benefit from the practice of meditation. And some of the families seated here are also taking the benefit. And we extend it to all parts of society, to all strata of society. And today, it's a very great opportunity for us to heartily welcome our Divine Sister Brahma Kumari Shivani Behen, who has come all the way from Delhi to be with us today. I should say she is our spiritual ambassador, reaching out to different parts of India and to the world. And as I have known her for the past 10 years or so, it's her qualities of simplicity, being available, just mixing. You feel very close to her when you just speak to her. So simple, but very heart-touching. I would say a leader in herself. A leader who practices what she shares. And just be mindful, for the past 5-6 years, she has come to our house, to our rooms, nearly every day. Am I right? Huh? We are all, wherever we are, whenever we get free, we surely remember her. And during the full day, I think most of us hear her at least once. So today, I once again heartily welcome her. And we look forward to her heartfelt sharing today also. And I also take this opportunity to welcome each one of you seated here in this gathering. Being a working day, but still you have taken out time from your regular schedule to be with us today. Welcome. Om Shanti. Thank you.
Thank you, Sister Beena. Request Mrs. Sri Vaishnavi Anush, Chairperson, Flow Coimbatore Chapter, to welcome the gathering.
Good evening to all of you. It is indeed an honor and a privilege to extend a hearty welcome to Brahma Kumari, Sister Shivani, on behalf of Fiki Ladies Organization, Coimbatore. I would also like to welcome Brahma Kumari Sister Beena and Brahma Kumari Sister Koday, who have been instrumental in helping us put together what promises to be a spectacular evening for all of us. We at Flow Coimbatore are committed towards women empowerment and have always believed that holistic empowerment is as important as economic empowerment. A long-pending desire of ours has been fulfilled today with Sister Shivani's gracious presence in our midst. I would like to take this opportunity to extend a warm welcome to the distinguished guests, our title sponsor for the evening, the past chairpersons of Flow Coimbatore, the past national president, Fiki Ladies Organization, Flow members, special invitees, and members of the press. Let us now look forward to a memorable evening of learning and emotional enrichment. Thank you for being here with us today.
I would like to invite Mrs. Kavita Vardaraj, past national president, Fiki Ladies Organization, to honor Brahma Kumari, Sister Shivani. May I request Mrs. Vaishnavi, Chairperson Flow Coimbatore Chapter, to present a memento to Brahma Kumari, Sister Shivani. I would like to invite Mrs. Venkat Lakshmi, past chairperson, Flow Coimbatore Chapter, to honor Brahma Kumari, Sister Beena. Mrs. Mohana Sundari, immediate past chairperson, Flow Coimbatore Chapter, to honor Brahma Kumari, Sister Koday. Presidents, we would like to commence on an auspicious note by lighting the lamp. Our pleasure to invite Brahma Kumari, chief guest of the evening, Sister Shivani, to please step forward to light the lamp. Inviting Brahma Kumari, Sister Beena. My pleasure to invite the Inspector General of Police, Mr. Shankar, to please step forward to light the lamp. My pleasure to request our sponsor, Mr. Anand Kumar of RBL Bank Limited, to please step forward to light the lamp. Inviting our president, Flow Coimbatore Chapter, Mrs. Sri Vaishnavi Anush, to light the lamp for the evening. Would like to invite the Inspector General of Police to please come forward and light the lamp. Thank you, dignitaries. May I request Brahma Kumari, Sister Kodai to introduce Sister Shivani.
Om Shanti. Good evening to all my spiritual brothers and sisters. It is such a pleasure and my privilege to introduce one of the most inspiring, eloquent and effective speakers, motivators of our times, Brahma Kumari, Sister Shivani. Sister Shivani, as you all may be knowing, has been enlightening and enriching the lives of millions around the world through her insightful programs. Her programs are not merely lectures laced with fables and catchy phrases and jargon. They stand apart because they are heart-to-heart conversations. Conversations which touch the core of our being and inspire us to do something based on what we've heard from her. And I've always wondered, what is that secret behind Sister Shivani holding sway over her audience? And I'd like to reveal that secret to you. Would any of you like to guess it? And the secret is, she lives what she talks. And she talks only what she believes in. And this is the secret, not only behind the sway sister has over her audience, she has a sway over God too. This is something you didn't know, right? This morning, when a few of us were driving to the airport to receive sister, it was so foggy. Few feet away, we could not see anything. So cloudy. It's been raining all along past week. And we were making preparations. If it rains, how would people come that side, this side? That's us. You know what Sister Shivani did? I believe the pilot announced when the flight was about to land in Coimbatore that it would be turbulent weather and the city has been experiencing incessant rainfall. You know what she did? That's what shows that she stands apart. She said, I just told Baba, Baba, no more rains until tomorrow's program. And I tell you, I promise you, I saw sunlight this morning. It hasn't rained ever since she set foot in our city. That's the sway she has over God too. And she's very open about it. She doesn't keep secrets behind. She's here all the way from Delhi to reveal the secrets that sets her apart. It was 20 years ago that she came into contact with the Brahma Kumaris. And she's very open about it. She says, initially, when they used to call her, she used to go far away from the Brahma Kumaris. She's not one who's forced into anything. But it was curiosity that got the better of her, because her mother was going to the Brahma Kumaris. And seeing her mother dramatically transform, seeing the immense strength that her mother derived after going to the Brahma Kumaris, sister decided to explore the secret. What's the secret that's leading to this transformation? And ever since, she's been a serious, intense practitioner of Raj Yoga meditation. Her own logical and analytical skills help her to experiment with the concept start at the Brahma Kumaris in her own life's situations. And the result is who we have here today. She's an embodiment of knowledge. She's an example of divinity through simplicity, and she's an exceptionally articulate motivator. The young and the old, men and women, even children, derive a lot of support, comfort, inspiration and guidance from her. And before I sign off, I'd like to tell you, there's not been a moment when Sister considered herself to be an orator or a speaker or a teacher. That's her humility. She's always been a student of God, working on herself, finding secrets and sharing it with the world. So let me allow Brahma Kumari, Sister Shivani, to open the floodgates of her inspiring words. Om Shanti.
What we've been waiting for has come. We are truly eager to listen to your address and listen to your words of inspiration. Inviting Brahma Kumari, Sister Shivani, to address the gathering.
Om Shanti. At the Brahma Kumaris, the greeting that we exchange every time we meet each other is Om Shanti, which means, Om means Aham Atma, I the soul, the being, and Shanti means peace. So it's a gentle reminder to ourselves and to the other soul whom we are greeting that I the soul am a peaceful soul. So all of us have said the word and recited the mantra Om Shanti many times, but sometimes it only remains as a word. A very beautiful word, a very powerful word, a very soothing word. But there's a difference between a word and becoming the consciousness of its meaning. So Om Shanti means my innate nature. Whatever I may see today, I may see anger, I may see aggression, I may see fear in myself, I may see hurt, I may see upsetness, but my original nature, I am a peaceful soul. Om Shanti. So anytime you feel a little away from your Shanti, so just say it to yourself. And you can also say it gently to someone else who's shifting away from their Shanti. Because it's very important, really important to know who we really are. Unless we know who I really am and what are my qualities, what's my strength, what's my originality, I will not be able to use it in my day-to-day karma. The topic this evening is feeling great no matter what. Do you believe that line? Love to believe it. Listen to the line carefully. Feeling great, no matter what, that has to be underlined. Feeling great, we all feel great, but it is conditional. It is dependent. It is not no matter what. So, do we feel it is possible to be feeling great no matter what? Yes, Geeta Ben, is it possible, feeling great no matter what?
Trying to get there.
How many feel it's possible to be feeling good irrespective of what's happening outside? Okay, let's do a gentle exercise. Sit back, comfortable. Rewind today's day. It could be today, it could be yesterday. Just reflect on the day. Or in the last week, or on the journey of your life. Just sit back comfortable, eyes open, close, whatever you're comfortable. Everyone who's standing and moving around can just sit. Just look at yourself. The journey of my life, my work, my relationships, my family, my friends, my my social responsibilities. As I play my every role, fulfill my every responsibility, perform my every karma, let me look at my state of being, how I feel. What is it? Who is it that disturbs my state of mind? I'm peaceful, calm, relaxed, and very happy. And then what is it that shifts me from my originality? What is it that causes me to create slight irritation, aggression, even hatred sometimes, hurt, fear, rejection, jealousy? None of these emotions make me feel nice, but what is it that causes me to feel this? I want to be happy, and I want to be happy always. Do I have a choice? What is it that shifts me from my state of stability, happiness, and peace? Let me just check today, half the day that has passed. What was the reason? What was the situation, the stimulus that caused my mind to shift? The being is originally pure, happy, peaceful, loveful, original nature. Somewhere down the line, we acquired hurt, anger, jealousy, and another complete list altogether. And now we've been using that list so often that we've started believing that is our nature. Because we are experiencing that nature more than our original nature. And then we are making effort to seek our original nature. We're looking for happiness. We're looking for peace. We're asking for love. We are demanding respect. How many of us are looking for happiness? Okay, the golden rule for the next 1 hour, that whatever we think of, we only have to think of for me, not for everyone. Because what happens when we generalize it and we say everyone, and the best part is that normally everyone says everyone, Why do you think we must be saying everyone? Why do we say everyone instead of saying me? Why do we say everyone? Is everyone looking for happiness? Everyone. Does anyone get angry? We say everyone. Does anyone get hurt? We say everyone. So why do we say everyone? And what's the risk when we say everyone? Hanji? No, we include ourselves because we say everyone. But what? Why do we say everyone? Ji? Humne sabki photo khich li? Brother? I thought by now he would have captured all your beautiful faces, because otherwise they can keep clicking for the next 2 hours. They'll click the same thing again and again and again. Why do we say everyone? No, why do we say everyone? No, no, is anyone seeking happiness? We say yes, everyone. Does anyone get angry? We say yes, everyone. So why do we say everyone? Why don't we say yes, me? We are part of it. But the minute we say everyone, what will happen? So it's fine. You see? So the minute I'm going to say everyone is ill, you see, if I say, does anyone have 100 degrees temperature now? And you say everyone, within 5 minutes, 100 will be counted as the normal body temperature because it's everyone. It's going to be an illness only if it's one or two people. But the minute it becomes everyone, then that will be taken as the normal body temperature. So when we started saying angry, everyone, hurt, everyone, seeking happiness, everyone, we started thinking this was the normal way of being because it's everyone. So for the next 1 hour, we won't think of everyone, we'll just think of one person. Me. Am I seeking happiness where? Where do we seek happiness? What all do we look for happiness? What all do we look for? Where do we look for happiness? In the beautiful sari that you're wearing today? How many of us buy beautiful, expensive clothes because it'll give us happiness? No one? Everyone. There it goes. It's everyone. It's not only me, it's everyone. Okay. How many of us would like to buy a nice expensive car because it will give me happiness? Then it's going to be everyone. And if I want to go on a nice holiday abroad for happiness, it is because it's everyone. Now let me just take the whole list, whether it is objects, whether it is possessions, whether it is my achievements. It may not just be objects, it may be achievements. In everything, I have been looking for happiness. But what happened down the line? Today, we probably have almost everything that we wanted. Do you think we have almost everything that we wanted? Yes? But we're still here talking about feeling great no matter what. So now what next should we buy? And that's why look at the entire media industry, entire advertising industry. They are using this one belief system and they're making billions out of it, because every day they're selling something to us and saying, buy this and you will be happy. And you bought this phone and after 6 months I'll give you a new version and say, no, iPhone 5 did not give you happiness, but buy iPhone 6 and that will give you happiness. And there it is, we are right there making our order before the product is in the market, thinking that, okay, 5 did not give me happiness, 6 will, so let me buy that. People are making billions out of this one belief system of ours. Because they said, buy this and you will be happy. And we believed it and we kept buying, buying, buying. But were we buying the product or were we trying to buy happiness? It's fine to buy the product. With clarity, what is the product going to be of use of? But if the subtle intention below that was that this product will give me happiness, then I have almost everything today. Then why am I still looking for happiness? I have everything. I have everything that I can buy. I have achieved everything that I wanted to. And yet I seem to be going from place to place seeking happiness, seeking peace of mind. One temple to the next. One saint to the next. Guruji, give me shanti. Can anyone give it to us? Can anyone give it to us? We go to a temple, it has peaceful vibrations. So while we're there, we experience peace. But can we buy that peace or grab that peace from there and get it home? Can all these objects really give us happiness? You wore a brand new sari today. You thought it's going to give you happiness. But the happiness is still pending till at least one person appreciates what we've bought. Yes? So you walk into the program here and you're having your cup of tea outside and you meet your first friend, second friend, fourth friend. Nobody's saying anything. So my happiness starts. And so what I do is I start appreciating the other person's sari, thinking at least the topic of sari should come up. This is how much we're literally standing like this till you appreciate, I won't be happy. This is a very risky situation. We stand like this. So I walk up to her and say, you're wearing such a beautiful sari. So that the next line will be, oh, yours is very good. You know, this is how we stand. This is how we stand. Literally, the word is not nice, but we are standing like this. And so the first person appreciates me and the second one says, beautiful sari. Third one says, you're looking really nice. And the fourth one walks in and says, Geeta, where did you buy it from? This color doesn't look nice on you at all. And where does her happiness go? The sari is still there? And where is the happiness gone? Now she probably doubts the sari. She definitely doubts her own choice. And she definitely hates me for what I have said. Yes, of course. And then what she will do next will be go up to another group of four people and say, or go up to her husband and say, how's my sari? I just bought. This is very nice. It's nice, na? Huh, of course, it's very nice. Look at her. She said it's not nice. Are chhod usko, what does she know? White clothes she wears. Does she know what is a good sari also? Who did you go and listen to? She said, okay. Every thought, every feeling, every emotion dependent on what someone else is going to say outside. Someone says, you're looking beautiful, I'm happy. The next person says, no, the sari is not looking nice, I go down. Then I go to someone else for a verification. They say, no, it's looking good, so I'm happy again. So I go. So feeling great no matter what is out of the window. It's dependent on every one line that people are speaking. This is how we've started living our life. Now, if we start living a life like this, where my state of being is going to be dependent on everyone outside, behaviors and situations, then being happy always is not possible. Because then my happiness is conditional that when people will be the way I want them to be, when situations will be the way I want them to be, then I will be happy. Right? Yes? When is it that our state of mind gets disturbed? When? Generally, when does it happen that we are not happy? When does it happen? We shift to a little irritation, a little anger, or a little hurt. When does it happen? Things don't go my way. One. And? Hanji? The desire is created. And that if the desire is not fulfilled, I'm not happy. In relationships, when is it that I'm not happy? expectations, which means people will not meet up to my expectations. Now look at the programming. Today we're here to change a little programming. When things don't go my way, when situations are not my way, when people are not my way, then I am not happy. And it's natural not to be happy, right? When things and people are not my way, is it natural not to be happy? Is it natural? No. It's a choice. When we say natural, it means there's no choice, it's automatic. But we have a choice. Is it possible that someone comes up to you and says, I don't like what you're wearing? Or someone comes up to you and says, it's not suiting you and it's not looking nice on you. Is it possible to listen to all this and remain stable? And I'm talking about very mundane things, but the equation remains the same, and then it can get applied to the most difficult situations of life. Is it possible that I come up to you and say, you're not looking nice in this, or I don't think this color is suiting you? Is it possible to remain? Think. Because we said feeling great no matter what. So I'm going to be one of those whats that will come into your life and just be very blunt and say, I don't think you chose a nice color. This doesn't look nice on you. So is it possible to remain stable and calm after listening to that? Today somebody will speak something about my clothes. Tomorrow someone will say about the way I work. Day after tomorrow someone will say about the person that I am. Different people will have different opinions about us. Sister, who chose the sari that you're wearing? Is it a gift or did you buy it? You bought it? You bought it. Who all went with you to choose this sari? Only yourself. Perfect. Now see what happens. Look at the risk that's involved. Why are you laughing? She is the subject now for us. She goes alone to buy the sari. And then she expects everyone to like it. Is it fair? Is it fair? Did she take me with her to choose the sari? If my choice matters, if my opinion matters so much, then you will have to take me with you to buy it. But if you don't take me with you to buy it, and then you expect that I should like it, is it fair? Actually, should it matter whether I like it or not? Should it matter whether I like it or not? Is it possible, sister, that all 400 people here will like the sari that you've bought? No. Lot of people are not going to like it, but many people will lie about it. And a few blunt people will go and speak the truth about it. But just because someone goes and speaks the truth, we don't like it. And then you know what we say? Even if she didn't like it, she didn't need to say it. And which means, please don't speak the truth to me because I don't have the power to listen to the truth. And that is what has encouraged us as a society to become very artificial and very hypocritical with each other. Don't you think we've become like that with each other? Oh, you're looking so nice. Oh, you're looking so beautiful. Oh, this. Andar se. How many of us are able to create something else inside and speak something else outside? Have you ever gone and said to someone, you're looking very beautiful, even if you didn't feel that the person was looking nice? Has anyone ever done that? Come on, don't tell me you have not done that. Or you have gone up to someone and said, it was lovely meeting you, we should meet again, and inside you're thinking, what a bore, I hope she never comes again. Have we ever done that? Yes, and that means we are living a life where we are cheating. There is no integrity with our own self, so where is the question of having integrity with anybody else outside? If there's no honesty within myself, there's no question of being honest to someone else outside. And why are we having to do this thing? Because people outside are not ready to listen to the truth. The other day, a lady calls me up. She says, I've come all the way from another city and I would like to meet you today. I said, I have a shooting. I will finish very late in the evening. So I am sorry, I cannot meet you today. She was very hurt. She said, this is not what I expected from you. On TV, you seem to be a nice person. I said, I'm really sorry, but can I know where I went wrong? She said, you hurt me by saying that you don't have time to meet me today. I said, honestly, I don't have time because I won't finish till about 8-9 in the evening. So she said, even if that was the case, you should have just said that you will try to meet me. I said, if I would have said, I will try to meet you, I would have kept you waiting, whereas I'm very clear that I will not be able to meet you. She said, you didn't need to be so blunt. You could have just said, I will try. At least it would have made me feel nice. So she was teaching me how to tell lies so that she will feel nice. And we have started doing that with each other. We have started doing that with each other. And when we do that too often, we're actually depleting soul power. We're not being honest. We are radiating something else inside, speaking something else outside, and doing something else completely different. There's no harmony. And why are we not able to speak the truth? Because people are not ready to listen to the truth. And why are people not ready to listen to the truth? Because their thoughts and feelings are dependent on every statement that is coming from outside. Is it possible that I go up to her and say, I don't like the color of your sari. Can she remain stable? Not yet. Can she remain stable? What does she have to create inside for her to remain stable after hearing a criticism? This is a criticism. Actually, it's my truth, but it can be taken as a criticism. It can be taken as an insult. What thought does she have to create inside for her to remain stable after listening to this comment? It's only a thought, it's only the mind. Right now, to get upset, she's going to have a lot of thoughts saying, how dare she speak to me? Has she seen her own dressing sense, her own clothes, and that too she came up to me? At least she should have kept quiet. And if she had to say it, she should have said it quietly outside in a corner. She said it when five people... And I go, what thought can she create so that she can remain stable after listening to that comment? We have to be very specific. What do I need to think inside for me to remain stable after listening to a comment which I feel is not pleasant?
I don't care.
I don't care. Acha. I like what I chose. Very good. Very important. See, you know why we're doing this? Because now you know that everyone knows all the answers. We all know the answers. It's only about creating these thoughts at that time. Okay, so one is, I like it. Second? Yeah, what's the thought? We have to have very clear thoughts. It is my opinion that I don't like it. Is it okay that I don't like it? Is it okay that I don't like it? Doesn't matter. See, only if we would have been like this, that it's a different color, you don't like it, doesn't matter, we would be feeling great no matter what. We cannot, beautiful, we cannot all think alike. Now, it's so easy to come up with this answer here. Now, the only thing is to take this answer back today out from this hall. Only this one line, only one line will change the quality of life. People are going to think different from me. Yes? People's likes and dislikes will be different from me. Yes? People's rights and wrongs definition will be different from me. Yes? Sure? How many of you like these flowers? Please raise your hands. because everyone is not allowed to say, no, we can't say everyone, so we'll have to raise hands. How many like these flowers? Okay. I don't like them at all. I don't like them at all. Is it okay? Is it okay? Sure. Any thoughts inside that I'm a very strange person not to like such beautiful flowers? Anyone created that thought? Honest. No one created this thought. One. Acha.
I'm thinking of
two.
The
what are you thinking about the organizers? That they're going to feel bad that I didn't like their flowers? Is it okay that I didn't like... No, I'm not. I'm just asking you because this is what's going to happen the whole day. What you like, I may not like. What you find right, I may not find right. And I could be the spouse, I could be the child, I could be your colleague, I could be your senior, I could be your junior. My like, your like will be different. My right, your right will be different. Is it okay that I don't like these flowers? Sure? 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 Between you and me, who is right? Be very careful. Don't answer just because everyone is saying it. And don't answer just because we're sitting here. Think. You like these flowers. Almost everyone on the planet like these flowers. And here I come and I say, I don't like these flowers at all. Between you and me, who is right? It's a point of view, yes. So between your point of view and my point of view, which is the right point of view? Different points, that's it. Between you and me, who is right? Both are right? A little more right? Both are equally right. Now, just go home today. Take one like this A4 size paper and please type on that always and always and always both are equally right. Feeling great always will happen. It will happen. It was so beautiful. Look at the energy. You are also right. I am also right. Both are right. Different perspective, different thought. So natural. Isn't it natural to have different perspective? But when we go back from here, we'll say, how could you say this? How could you do this? I just can't understand how you are like this. How strange you are like this. This is how you behave. We don't find people right. And that's why very easily we label them wrong. Very easily we label them bad. We never labeled them different. We said this was wrong. And the minute someone is wrong, according to me, what's the energy that I will radiate to the person? What's the energy that we will radiate to that soul? This is disrespect. You are wrong. I wear white color. I can give you a 1 hour talk on where, how white color is the best color to wear. Spiritually, environmentally, socially, financially. Saves a lot of money. Saves a lot of stress. I just have to open the cupboard. Everything looks the same. So pick anything out. So saves a lot of time and energy. White is absolutely the right color to wear. Would you start wearing white from tomorrow? I can give you 10 good, solid reasons why white is the right color to wear. Would you start wearing white color from tomorrow? I'm giving you valuable advice. I'm saying it for your good. Please think all these lines because you've said it to other people. And especially to your children. I'm saying this for your good. You do this. Would you agree to wear white from tomorrow? Can't you understand? It's for your good. Are you going to wear white from tomorrow? No. Why? 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 Huh? My choice. So now the next time we try and tell people what is good for them. It's good to tell them what's good for them, but don't expect that it will be always followed. It will not. And sometimes what we feel is good for them, they are not going to accept it as good for them. And sometimes we could feel that we are banging our head against the wall because the other person is just not listening, not understanding. And especially as a parent, it gets very frustrating. Say, my child just doesn't understand what's good for them. But what we forgot is when we are saying this is good for you, it was according to me. So what we were trying to actually tell them was, according to me, this is good. But we didn't say, according to me, this is good. We said, this is good for you. Who's going to decide what is good for them? Who's going to decide what is good for them? It's going to be the other person. Now, the little mistake that I have made is, white is right for me. If that was my belief system, white is right for me, then I would say, these beautiful colors are right for you. But if I go and make a little mistake and I say, white is right, and I remove the for me, I just say, white is right, then all the other colors are going to look as, then I will say, yellow, orange, black, how can you wear such horrible colors? Now the minute I radiate this energy from here, that the colors that you are wearing are wrong, they are bad, they are not nice. When I radiate this energy, I'm disrespecting your choice. I'm disrespecting your perspective. I'm disrespecting your sanskar. And when I send this energy from here, what's the energy that I'm going to get from there? What is the energy that I'm going to get from there? You're such a boring person, you wear only white. This is the thoughts that we throw at each other. When we are judgmental about people's perspectives, opinions, habits, nature, sanskar. Every soul is different. Every soul's thinking, feeling, emotion, sanskar is different. They are different from us. They are not wrong. What's the difference between the word wrong and different? The whole energy is different. If I say, I am wearing white, she's wearing red, we are different. It's respect. It's acceptance. But if I say, horrible, how can you wear red? Now this is disrespect. This is rejection. And when I send disrespect from here, that's the only thing I will get back from there. Will every soul have different sanskars? Will every soul have different sanskars? Why? Why can't our children just be like us? Life would be so simple. Why is every soul different? Why can't, like somebody said, I'm unhappy when people don't meet up to my expectations? Because we want people the way we want them to be. Why are they different? Why can't they just be what we want them to be? Why are they different? We want them to be the way we want them to be. Nah. It's like I wear white, so I feel white is right, so I will want everyone to wear white. Is it fair? Is it fair? That's the only reason for conflict in relationship. That's the only reason. Because we want people the way we want them to be. And people will want to be people will want to be like, how many benefits I told you, but yet you stuck to it and said nothing doing, we are not wearing white. And which means people will want to be the way they want to be. And this people can be our spouse, our children, not even an outsider. And then we could be every day. Why are souls so different? Why are people so different? Why is everyone so different? Each one's circumstances are different. Okay. Brother, if you don't mind, how old are you? How old are you? 52. Okay? Now everyone, on the screen of your mind, throw up the figure. How old are you? Got the figure? Okay. Now throw up the figure. How old is the dress that you're wearing? The sari, the shirt, whatever you're wearing. How old is that? Throw up the figure. For someone it could be one day. New dress today. Someone it will be 6 months. Now my dress is 6 months old. And I am 6 months old is a completely different thing. So my dress is 6 months old. When we say 40, 50, 60, whose age is that? Whose age is that? When we say, I am 50 years old, actually who is 50 years old? This body is 50 years old. Beautiful. See? So, my sari is 6 months old, my body is 40, 50 years old. How old am I? I. Now everyone threw up the figure. How old am I? I who's using this body. How old am I? Don't know? Right? Right. Now, look at how it's all working. About 40, 50 years we've been in this body. Okay? So me in this body for 40 years, you in this body for 40 years, my situations, your situations could have ever been the same? No? Completely different. So even in this costume that we are wearing, two people would never have had the same situations, same environment? No. And which means the recording that will happen on the soul in 40 years of this costume will be completely different? Yes? Okay. Before these 40 years, I was in another body and you were in another one. And suppose both of us lived in the earlier costume for 80 years. Could those 80 years have been same between you and me? So 80 years we had another recording, and before that another 100 years, and before that another 100 years, and another 100 years. So how much recording would we be carrying here? How much recording would we be carrying here? Right? It's like a CD, which has songs and songs and songs and songs and songs recorded of 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years, we don't know. Okay? Now my CD has songs of 5,000 years, let's say, and your CD also has songs of 5,000 years recorded. Could our songs be the same? Right? Now, these two CDs get married one day. Yeah. And they look at each other the next morning and say like, why are you different? Why are you like this? Why are you like this? Why are you like this? And then starts a whole journey of trying to change the songs of the other CD. Don't we try to change the songs of the other CD? Don't be like this, be like this, don't do like this, do like this. So instead of enjoying the music of the other CD, we're trying to change the songs of the other CD. And which songs do we want them to record? The ones which are there on my CD. Why do I want them to have those songs? Because those songs are the right songs. Those songs are the right songs. After 1 or 2 years, a third CD comes into the house. How old is that CD? How old is that CD? And these two people will look at that third CD and say, my child. And my child is going to be like me, or the way I want them to be. And then suddenly that CD starts playing different songs. We're like, how can my child be like this? Because simple, simple point of knowledge, which every Shastra gave us, every religious book gave us, every spiritual organization gave us, you are a soul. Now when we went for a satsang, we said, I am a soul. When we came back home, we said, my child. We didn't say soul, we said, my child. What a difference it created. Had we looked at our children and we had said, soul on a journey, just in this costume in my family, before that, different recordings. Will their sanskars and my sanskars be the same? Now is a whole journey in this present costume. Either we accept each other's songs, life will become beautiful. But if we try to control the other person's songs, we criticize them for their recording, we try to forcefully change their recording, then it's a journey of conflict. Soul, we've heard the word, but we don't live in that consciousness. The other day, a lady came to the center. She has a 5-year-old son. She said, my son is brilliant. He always excels at everything that he does. I said, good, carried powerful sanskars. She said, but there's only one problem. He gets very scared of water. She said, I love swimming. My husband is a swimmer of some national or some level. And my son doesn't like to go near water. Now, obviously, both of us want our son to be. So she said, the other Sunday, I prepared him from morning that when we go this evening for swimming, you will be swimming today. And she said, from morning I was preparing him. Today we're going swimming. Today we're going swimming. And by the evening when I took him to the pool, I took him there and then he just ran away. And she said, I got so angry, I held him, gave him two like this and threw him in the pool. And just impromptu, I just said to her, I said, you know, 6 years back there was a flood in that particular city. This soul left the body in that. She just looked at me. She said, you can see all this? I said, yes. And she believed it, just for that moment. At that moment, within 30 seconds, that lady says, obviously he'll get scared of water. I said, that's it, no? You don't know the past of the soul. You don't know what circumstances the soul has seen, what is the reason why he fears water, why is his sanskar different from you? You don't know, and you were ready to hit him for it, and in 30 seconds you are saying, obviously he will fear water. Only with one understanding, soul on a journey will carry different sanskars. Now look at all the souls around us. Parents, siblings, spouse, children, colleagues, soul on a journey. We don't know what everyone has seen, what everyone has gone through. Obviously different sanskars. Different sanskars. One person in the family could be very trusting. They trust everybody very easily. The spouse could have a nature who doubts very easily. Does that happen? One person would be very, very clean, everything perfect, perfect. And the other person like, possible? Now, there is two options. Understand each other's sanskar. Accept that this recording is because of something that's happened in the past. Accept the sanskar, radiate love, give power to the soul. The soul will try to change their sanskar. But reject the sanskar, criticize the sanskar, try to control the sanskar, or compare the sanskar with somebody else's sanskar, and we're taking the person far away from us. Is it possible one person can have a sanskar of doubt and another person will have a sanskar of trust? Yes? Now what will happen? Sanskar is like a filter. It's like a lens. If I have a sanskar of trust, whoever I see and whatever I see, I will only trust. Because that's my lens. And sometimes something could be completely wrong in front of me, but I will trust. Why? Because I have a lens of only trust. And here my spouse has a lens of doubt. So whatever they see, whoever they see, they will doubt. Who is right? Who is right between the two? Who is right between the two of them? For that soul who carries the sanskar of doubt, what they are saying and what they are doing is their right. They feel they're so convinced that this is right. Because that's all that they can see. It's their sanskar. If you tell them you are wrong, is it fair? Is it fair? No, because that lens is their lens. That lens is their lens. They can only see that color. If someone's going to walk up to them and say, you are wrong, then the immediate answer that you are going to get from there is, you are wrong. And then there is a... And then we bring out the wrongs of all the past so many years. When you were wrong and the other person says, you were wrong, and we can just bring up everything. Acceptance. This soul carries the sanskar of doubt. Something, somewhere, sometime has happened. Maybe he or she was betrayed, cheated, really, really went through a bad phase, because of which the soul has created a sanskar of doubt. And now the soul is not ready to trust. Because if they trust, they fear pain. Accept. This is respect. We are not able to respect each other today. Because we forget that there was a reason why this soul carried this sanskar. A year back there was an earthquake in Nepal. How many souls left the body? Few thousands? Okay. Post earthquake, there have been medical teams, psychiatrists, psychologists going repeatedly to do post-trauma counseling. Okay, and the other day it was in the Times of India, 25,000 people have gone through counseling because they are in post-trauma stress. Now, we are counseling the people who are in this body. What about the souls who left the body? Do they need post-trauma counseling? Do they need post-trauma counseling or they don't need? Now what's happening, those 2,000-3,000 souls who left the body, what would be their last state of being? Fear, pain, hurt, so much of emotion, and they bank into the womb of a mother and the baby in a few months out, and everybody looks at the baby and says, my baby, perfect baby. And the baby has come with pain, with hurt, with fear. Now this baby can't listen to loud noise, gets scared to go out alone, fears being in the dark, and the parent cannot understand, why is my child like this? Now this child will start getting criticism, sometimes even ridicule, and sometimes even comparison. Look at your sister, she's so smart, look at you. Do we do that? Imagine the state of the soul. They've gone through pain, they changed the costume, they've forgotten the earthquake, but they cannot erase the pain. They are in fear, they don't know the reason why they experience fear. And here the next set of family that they get doesn't understand their fear, but in fact makes fun of them, ridicules them, criticizes them, rejects them for that sanskar. So they had fear of this percentage, and by criticizing and comparing them, what are we doing to the soul? We add pain to people's pain. Do they need counseling? Do they need counseling? And now this is not only those 2,000-3,000 souls, it's actually all the souls around us. Everyone's gone through something or the other. Whether it is in this costume or whether it is in some costume before, because of which we are carrying ego, we are carrying a lot of complex emotions inside, and that's why we've become very complicated people. We're very complicated with our mindset. We're not simple. She did this, so I will do this, so I will. We manipulate a lot inside. But that's something to do with the past sanskar that I carry of ego, of manipulation, of being shrewd, of being very judgmental. Do I need criticism or do I need love and support to heal myself? What do I need? Everyone around us, not necessarily only the people whom you feel are feeling a little low, but people who are very arrogant. They're arrogant because they're hiding something inside. What do they need? What does everyone need? What does everyone need? They need love. They need acceptance. Nowadays it's become very common to say to each other, family, children, I love you, I love you, I love you. It's become like a signature. Every phone call, every message, every time you're going out of the house, love you, love you, love you. You don't need to say it so many times actually. But we say it, but that's fine. But today let's change the line so that it becomes a reality. The line is not I love you. The line is I accept you. Say it again and again, again and again and again. Now keep saying it every time. Signing off every message. I accept you. I accept you. I accept you. If we don't accept people, where's love? If I accept her sanskar, my original vibration of love will radiate. The minute I'm judgmental about her, my energy of love will block and my energy of criticism will radiate. We don't love people always, it fluctuates. Sometimes it's love, sometimes it's judgmental, sometimes it's criticism, sometimes it's acceptance. It's not a generalized emotion. So instead of saying, I love you every time, let's start saying, I accept you. Because we understand the journey of the soul. Every soul today only needs acceptance. Acceptance means respect. Now if I see a sanskar in her, which I feel is not right for her, if I'm judgmental and critical, I'm sending a lot of negative energy. This negative energy will deplete soul power, and if soul power gets depleted, then the possibility of that sanskar changing finishes off. But if I accept that sanskar, okay, this soul is carrying this sanskar, fine. She has a lot of other beautiful sanskars. And I respect her. No judgmental thoughts, no critical thoughts here. So what's the vibration that's going to radiate? This is respect and love. When this vibration goes to her, soul power will increase. When soul power will increase, she'll be able to work on her sanskar. We all have the power to either deplete people around us or to empower the people around us. And while we deplete other people, who's the first person who will get depleted? Will be myself. And while I send acceptance and respect to the other person, who will be the first person who will get empowered? Will be myself. It's a very connected energy. If I'm empowering her, I will get empowered first. Can we start a chain of accepting people as they are? look at everyone's lives today. What we see of people outside is not what is actually happening in their lives. It is definitely not what's happening in their minds. You can meet people in the best car, wearing the best clothes, but they're extremely in pain inside. Possible? Possible? That pain could be a pain created of this lifetime. It could be a baggage carried from the past somewhere. Every soul needs acceptance and love. So the word expectation . What do we normally expect from people? Because we get hurt, no? Because our expectations are not met. What do we normally expect which doesn't get fulfilled and we are hurt? Any example? Hanji? We expect from others. Any example that we expect something and we don't get it, so we are hurt? Just a smile. The other day one lady comes up to me backstage and she says, "I've been watching your program for very long, it's good." I said, "Okay, good." She said, "But you know what, we are human beings." I said, "Yes. It's natural to expect." I said, "Okay, what do you want to expect?" She said, "I expect little love, little respect." I said, "But Ben, what's little for you? Maybe more than my capacity to give, no? Possible? You come up to me right now and say, I expect you to lend me a little money." I say, "How much?" You say, "Only 500. I say, "I don't have." You said, "I expected only 500. I said, "I don't even have 5. And now you're going to get hurt. What did I ask of her? Only 500? Do I not even deserve 500? Is this why I got married to her? She can't even give me 500? This is how we talk. Isn't this how we talk? When we say, "I expect little love," what is the definition of that little love? Little for you, but beyond my capacity because I am like... Little respect. I expect my daughter-in-law little respect. A definition of little respect, who will define that little respect? So let's not stand like this. Not a very nice feeling. Please give me little love. Walk up to people and shower them with your love. What is this? If I stand like this, what will happen? What will happen if we stand like this in front of our spouse, our son, our daughter-in-law? Stand like this. Give me little love. What's the risk? You travel in your car, people come and stand like this. Okay? What are the different possibilities that happen when someone comes and stands like this? Kya kya hota hai? Aage badho. Aage badho. Yeah, aage badho. So the person keeps knocking. Ek bar, do bar, teen bar. Teen bar ke baad that person leaves. We are knocking since years. But we are still standing like this. Little love. The other soul is an ego. They don't have love. You have a choice, either give it to them or move on, but definitely don't stand like this, they don't have it. So if I'm going to say to myself, I am a human being, so I expect at least little love, at least little respect, then I will have to write a third line. If these expectations are not met, then I'm writing a destiny of hurt for myself. So if you're ready to experience the hurt, keep on having the list of expectations. It's Kali Yuga. Do you feel it's Kali Yuga? Yes, which yuga is it? Kali Yuga. And Kali Yuga means, how is every soul battery going to be? Why is it called Kali Yuga? Kaliyug means kalhe kalesh ka yug, dukh ashanti ka yug. So the soul is like a battery. So in Kaliyug, how is the battery going to be? Full, half, empty. Yeah, almost empty actually. Not empty, but the last line of that phone, you know, that much battery. Now look at everyone around you. Souls in Kaliyug. Battery is discharged. We are going and standing in front of them and saying, give me love. Give me respect. Battery is discharged. It's like walking up to a bankrupt person and saying, give me a loan. Whose mistake is it? The other person who didn't give it, or my mistake that I made the expectation? It's Kaliyug, and Kaliyug means souls have become very, very weak. And if we are going to go and ask them for it, and then we are not going to get it, and then we are going to get hurt, and then we are going to blame them for our hurt, which only means we weaken ourselves. So today we have a choice. When we go out from here, we can either continue living our life like this, or from today we start living our life like this. Which yug is this? Which yug is this? This is Kaliyug. Which yug is this? Satyug. And who are the souls in Satyug? They are Devi Devtas. Devi Devtas means the one who gives. Kaliyug, we became like this. And now we are at the end of Kaliyug, so we are not even like this, we are like this. Yes. Now which yug will come after this? Morning, afternoon, evening, night, pitch darkness, after that, morning again. Satyug, Treta Yug, Dwapar Yug, Kaliyug, Ghor Kaliyug. Now what will happen after Ghor Kaliyug? What will happen after Ghor Kaliyug? Satyug again. Morning, afternoon, evening, night, morning, afternoon, evening, night, morning, afternoon, evening, night. Satyug to Kaliyug, and now after Kaliyug? Satyug. Now from Kaliyug to Satyug, how will it happen? Transformation. How will we be able to create Satyug from this Kaliyug? Who will create this Satyug? Who has created this Kaliyug? Who's created this Kaliyug? We created the Kaliyug. Now we want a better world. We're all saying we want a better world. And God says, yes, that world is almost here. And it's Satyug. It's not just a better world. It's a brand new world. A better could be just like 5% better would also be better world. But it's not going to be a better world. It's going to be heaven. It's going to be paradise. It's going to be Satyug. How will this Satyug happen? How will it happen? How will it happen? Think. We want a world where how will the souls be? How will the souls be? Divine, complete, perfect. They will not be like this, they will be like this. So saying, obviously I'll expect a little love. Instead of that, they will say, I give love. They don't expect respect, they say, I give respect. They don't expect honesty, they say, I give honesty. That is Devi Devtas. Is it possible that we can go back from this hall and live like that? Go back to your family, go back to your workplace. Instead of like this, say, I will give. When we give, who's the first person who will get it? When we give, the first person who will get it will be me. So when I give it to the other people, the first battery which will get charged will be me. When I stand like this, the first battery which gets depleted is me. So the consciousness shift. Satyug means Dene Vale, Devi Devta. Kaliyug means mangne wale. So can we go back today? We came from Kaliyug, let's go back to Satyug. 6 o'clock we came from Kaliyug, 8 o'clock we go back to Satyug. Possible? How would the sanskars of Satyug be? What sanskars would we carry in Satyug? What are the sanskars? Hanji? Love, peace, what else? Hanji? Acceptance, what else? Divinity, purity, royalty. Now, just go back. I am a Satyugi soul. But you will have to go back to souls who are in Kaliyug. So they will behave in a Kaliyug manner and we need to respond in the Satyug manner. Possible? Possible? Very easy. It's like a hospital. The patient who will walk in is the Kaliyugi soul, which means person who is ill, who is in emotional pain. But the doctor doesn't fall ill looking at the patient. The doctor remembers, who am I? Who am I? I am a healer. They have come in pain. I am a healer. So they will only get into healing the person. So now everyone around me is in a little pain. Some baggage they are carrying, some past hurt, something that is there on their mind, they are in pain. Am I going to stand like this or am I going to heal them? Does a doctor ever say to the patient, at least you heal me little bit, then I will heal you? We do this. We are healers. We are Satyugi souls. And anyone who creates that thought will become that. Anyone, just about anyone can do this. Only a shift of consciousness from begging to giving. Just 2 days back we celebrate Diwali and we all draw this swastik. Yes, for the Lakshmi Puja we draw swastik. And whenever there is any function, any program, any new house, new car, we draw swastik. Look at the swastik. Four parts. Four equal parts, right? Now look at the four parts. The first part, the hand is like this. This is Satyug, where the hand will be the one which gives blessings. Second part, the hand is like this. Third part, Dwaparyug, the hand becomes like this. Third part is like this, na? Hand like this. Fourth part, Kaliyug, Satyug, Treta Yug, Dwapar Yug, Kaliyug. That is swastik. And then we draw a bindi in all the four parts. Bindi means I the soul. I the soul was in Satyug, then I the soul was in Treta Yug, then I the soul was in Kaliyug, now I the soul will be in Satyug again. This is self-realization, swastika, swa-astitva, self-realization. But we only draw like this and we say shubh shubh. Shubh means it will be shubh when I know I am a soul, I have these divine sanskars, and out of those sanskars when I do any karma, it will be shubh. Not only by drawing, but by drawing that consciousness here. Who will be the souls in Satyug? Just visualize a scene. There is heaven on this planet. It's Satyug. All souls are fully charged, battery fully charged. Beautiful soul, beautiful body, beautiful nature, paradise on earth. The soul leaves one body, takes another one, leaves one body, takes another one, and another one, and another one. Satyug to Tretayug, Tretayug to Dwaparyug, Dwaparyug to Kaliyug. The souls who were in Satyug, where are they today? The souls who were in Satyug, where are they today? Kaliyug. We were in the morning, very fresh, charged, energetic. By late evening, now we are tired. Same people in the morning, same people in the night. And now same people will rest, recharge, refresh and be fresh in the morning. Right? Souls in Satyug, charged, powerful, pure. Souls in Kaliyug, tired, depleted, in pain. So the souls who were in Satyug, where are they today? Where are they today? Here. Here. And who are the souls now who will be in Satyug? They are in Kaliyug today. They will do something because of which they will create Satyug. Satyanarayan ki katha karte. You know what they say? Nar aisi karni kare jo nar se narayan. Aisa kehte? Nar se narayan. Nari se Lakshmi bane. How many times we must have heard this katha? Nar se Narayan, Nari se Lakshmi. Nar and Nari means which yug? Nar and Nari means which yug? Kaliyug. Lakshmi and Narayan means which yug? Satyug. Now see, the katha said, Nar kuch aisa karega jo Nar se Narayan ban jayega. Aur Nari se Lakshmi ban jayega. To Nar and Nari kon? Hum sab. Lakshmi Narayan kon? Nar and Nari kon? Hum sab. Lakshmi Narayan kon? Bolo bolo. Lakshmi Narayan kon? That's all. Mandir kyun jane ki zarurat hai? When we go to the temple, it should be with the pure intention. Look at those divine souls and emerge that divinity within. Not only just go and worship them and remain as we are. And then when we worship them, we say, main neech hu, papi hu, ye hu, wo hu, aap sola kala sampan, aap sampur nirvikari. Main ye hu, lekin main banne kaise wala hu? Aise wala. To nar aur nari ab kya banenge? Lakshmi Narayan. And jab hum Lakshmi Narayan banenge, to satyug aa jayega. To wo Lakshmi Narayan hum kab banenge? Kab banenge? To 6 o'clock we came in as nar nari. 8 o'clock we go back as? It doesn't take more time than that. Yes? Ready? Yes. So we complete the Satyanarayan Kathana. So we came as Nar Nari and we go back as Lakshmi Narayan, which means we came like this asking for happiness, asking for love, looking for peace, but we will go back like this. Because we understand that it's Kaliyug and people don't have what we want from them. So keeping expectations now is a little unfair. It's a little unfair. It's unfair to us, it's unfair even to the other soul. Accepting each one's sanskars. They've been on a long journey. Respecting them for their sanskars and radiating our love. If we just shift this consciousness, then feeling great the entire day is very, very simple. Lakshmi Narayan can never get upset. Lakshmi Narayan not going to get upset. Lakshmi Narayan not going to get angry. Lakshmi Narayan's hand is only like this. And like this means irrespective of whatever sanskars come before me, I radiate only good wishes and blessings. Devi Devta Ashirvad dete hai. Ashirvad means blessings, means non-judgmental, acceptance, blessings. Blessings. So, who are the Satyogi souls? All here. Each soul here has that Satyogi sanskars recorded. We only have to start using them. Divinity is our sanskar. Purity is our sanskar. Pyar se meetha baat karna is our sanskar. We only have to start using it. The CD has a lot of songs. But we've got used to just playing 5-10 songs the whole day. You know, on the phone nowadays you have a playlist. So songs which we hear too often, they go into the playlist and then that goes into an automatic mode. So we selected 5-10 songs and it's going on to the automatic mode. Remaining 100 songs are there, not being used at all. But they are there. They are there. I am a divine soul. Yes? Yes. It's the truth. It's the truth. I only have to start using that divinity. And when I start using that divinity and radiating it to the other person, I will emerge the divinity in them. When we go to a temple, when we go and meet a saint, a mahatma, why do we feel peaceful? Because in their presence of peace, we are able to emerge our sanskar of peace. Because it's there. We only have to start using it. So homework for tomorrow starts from tonight. From tonight and tomorrow entire Saturday, we are playing the role of Lakshmi Narayan. You can choose Lakshmi or Narayan, whatever you like. Ready? 24 hours? Think like Lakshmi Narayan, feel like Lakshmi Narayan, speak like Lakshmi Narayan, behave like Lakshmi Narayan. Don't do like this, but from here, it has to be all internal, nothing like this. Possible for 24 hours? How many feel I can do it for 24 hours? People outside are not Lakshmi Narayan, but. And that's why, if you see, all the Shastras are showing stories of the conflict between the Devtas and the Asur. In Satyug, there will be no Asur. When actual Devi Devtas are there on this planet, there will be no Asur. Satyug mein, there is no Asur. It's only this transformation stage where there will be sanskars of Asur and also there will be sanskars of Devi Devta. So next 24 hours, I am Lakshmi Narayan. Just for 24 hours, just to see our own potential of divinity. Just to see how pure and divine I am and what am I using the whole day. What am I using? And then if you like it for 24 hours, next 24 hours is your choice. This 24 hours is homework. Next 24 hours after that, your choice. Which sanskar feels nicer, more comfortable, and most important, we will shift from like this. The old sanskar might pop up sometimes and say, but I want, quickly counsel your mind. Quickly counsel your mind, sit back, talk to it for 2 minutes, give it the gyan and it will be back to what it is supposed to be. Our mind is like a child, they will listen to what we say. We only have to speak to it the correct language. Speak to it gently, softly, with love, it will listen. Ready? So the program is not for 2 hours, the program is for 24 hours. 24 hours. And tomorrow morning, anyone planning to come tomorrow morning? Tomorrow morning we will see our entire karmic pattern. There are certain things that are happening nowadays in our life which we're not liking. And the first thing that comes to mind is, why did this happen to me? It's become a very big question. Why did this happen to me? Why did this happen to me? We need answers. Because till we get answers, the mind will not silence. Until the mind doesn't silence, it doesn't focus on healing and solutions. So we see that tomorrow. How to create a destiny of our choice. Just to make this whole journey very easy. To emerge those divine sanskars. Don't have to put so much effort, just to make it natural. Connecting to the Supreme Power. For the battery to get charged, the easiest way is the battery to get connected to the power supply. If a battery tries to charge itself, it's a little effort. But if a battery connects to the power supply, it's natural. Meditation is connection of that Supreme Being with the soul. we all pray. But when we pray, sometimes it's only the words that we are saying. Our mind is sometimes, and so the charging doesn't happen. The charging will not happen till the mind is connected to the Supreme Power, not just the words and the hands. Today our prayers are more with the words and the hands. The flowers, the agarbatti, everything is beautiful if the mind is also doing it. But if my hands and my mouth is here but my mind is at work, then charging will not happen. If my mind is thinking about something that happened yesterday but I finished the whole aarti, charging will not happen. Does it happen sometimes like that? We finished the whole aarti, we finished the whole bhajan, and the mind finished all the office work and came in that much time. So then the charging doesn't happen. So meditation means how to make the mind concentrate on what it's supposed to be doing, connecting to that Supreme Power and channelizing His energy into our life. That's Raj Yoga meditation. So at every center in the city, the sisters are there to share how to do this Raj Yoga meditation. And there's a 7 days Raj Yoga meditation course at every center, an hour every day. An hour which you choose, your convenience, your time. Just have to fix that with the sisters for 1 week. An hour every day is just 7 hours of our time to go and learn that beautiful technique of empowering ourselves. When we empower ourselves, our vibrations will empower other people around us. If one member in the family, only one member in the family, charges their battery, don't you think they'll be able to help and other people charge a little bit? Yes? So let's become that one person. Let's become that one person for our family, for our workplace. If I charge myself, I'll be able to help the rest of the family to charge themselves. And together, if we're all doing this, Satyug is on the next corner. It's really, really near. It's really near. I only need to ask myself, am I going to be contributing towards creating it? We are at a tipping point. A huge population is only going to live in Kali Yuga and enforce Kali Yuga. And a small population is going to get ready to work a little bit on themselves and create the new world. It's something similar to the freedom struggle of the country. Majority people will continue living the life of slavery and a victim. They are living in bondage. Bondage of our own weaknesses, our own negativities. We are slave to our weaknesses. Few people are going to say we want freedom. And we are ready to do anything to get that freedom. But when few people work towards that freedom, everyone will get that freedom. Because Satyug will be on this planet for the whole world then. But a small number of population will have to work for it. So you need to ask yourself, do you want to continue living in Kali Yuga or want to be a part of creating that new world? Yes? Yes? Life becomes very beautiful. Very beautiful. Because when the soul starts using its divine sanskars, it's at ease. It becomes at ease. It's very peaceful. No anxiety, no pain, no stress. Absolutely comfortable. So from 15th, that is from Sunday, is this been given to everyone? You have it with you? To give it to, will you email the addresses? Okay. So sister will email the addresses of the centers to you, but I'll share the time with you. It's from 15th to the 21st of November, and the two timings, 6:30 to 7:30 in the morning or 6:30 to 7:30 in the evening. One of the two times at all the four centers that are there at the city. 6:30 to 7:30 in the morning or 6:30 to 7:30 in the evening. In case both the times are not convenient or these dates are not convenient, then you just need to walk up to the center and fix any day, any time. Sisters are always there. to share with us this beautiful technique of Rajyoga meditation. Come, let's sit back now, prepare for our Satyoga. Let's do a small experiment today. As we finish our meditation, let's move out of the hall in silence and probably drive up to our homes in silence today. It would take about 15-20 minutes, half an hour. At least next 15 minutes, mourn, silence. How many ready to do 15 minutes of silence? Beautiful. Silence gives power to the soul. So that everything that we have shared, it will go and get embedded in the subconscious of the mind. And then it becomes our property. If we immediately take the mind to other things, we scatter it off. And we probably drop it here and don't take the prasad home. This is the prasad. His knowledge is the prasad we get. And let's carry that prasad home. See why prasad is so valuable. We get this much prasad, we take it. We don't eat it. What do? We go home. And then everyone we meet, what do? Thoda, 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 thoda. That's prasad. So our vibrations that we create here now with this jnana is the prasad that we will carry home. So whoever meet, they will get touched by our vibration. That means we've given the prasad to them. So accepting each soul's sanskars, people have a right on their opinion, their perspective, and like very beautifully we said today, it's okay if you don't like her sari, it's your choice. So anyone says anything to you tomorrow? It's okay, their choice, their opinion, their perspective, their sanskar. Soul on a journey, different sanskars they are carrying. When you go back home today, look at every member of the family. Soul on a journey. Don't know what all they've gone through. That's why nowadays people go in for past life regression, just to find out. Don't need to find out. Why do we need to find out? We just need to have an understanding that yes, we have gone through something. Don't need to go and find out what we have gone through. It is we have gone through and we accept it today. And we are going back with a new consciousness. Only to give, give, give and give. People out in the world say relationship means give and take. Does relationship means give and take? Business means give and take. Relationship means give, 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 only give. Kab tak? Kab tak? Till when can I only keep giving and giving and giving? Always. Always. And while I'm giving, I'll be the first person who will get filled. Filled. So Satyogi souls, sit back, reflect, comfortable. Let me look at myself. I, the being, the master of this body, the energy, the creator of every thought and feeling. I, the soul, have been on a long journey. I started this journey with Satyoga, where I was charged, I was powerful, I was divine. Divinity is my sanskar. Many lives, different situations. Today I've reached the pitch darkness. Kaliyug. But my original sanskar is still divinity, peace and love. And from today, I'm going to consciously choose to use my divine sanskars. Whatever may be the situation, however people may behave, I am a divine soul. I am a Devi Devta soul. For the next 24 hours. Different appointments, different responsibilities, meetings, interactions, everything outside remains the same. But my way of being, the vibrations I create and radiate, vibration of divinity, acceptance and love. I accept each one sanskar. And as I accept them, I radiate blessings and good wishes. Bring any one soul before you whose any one sanskar disturbed the state of mind, any one habit which always created a little irritation or hurt. Look at them again. It's somewhere on this journey. Something happened and they created this sanskar. Today, I accept this sanskar. Their sanskar will not influence my state of being. I remain stable. God, my Father, the Supreme Power, has come to give me the Gyan and the power to create the new world. I am a creator of Satyug. As I go back home today, I look at myself and check my sanskars. And immerse that sanskar of divinity, my every thought, feeling, word and behavior, divine. This knowledge that I have absorbed is the prasad that I will take back home. And I will share my vibrations with everyone. we can start moving very gently. Angels, in silence, down. Next 15 minutes, absolute silence. Keep taking care that we don't drop these vibrations on the way. We have to carry them home. Blessings to all, accepting each one's success.